In this lesson, we'll discuss an example of a type 1 pipe flow problem. On the right, we have a diagram showing part of a pipe system. Water at 60 degrees Fahrenheit enters the pipe system at 1, is transported uphill, and exits through a faucet at 2. The flow rate through this system is steady at 12 gallons per minute. There are 6 sections of pipe of various length, which are connected by 4 90-degree elbows and 1 fully open globe valve. The pipes are made of copper using a drawn tubing process, and their diameter is 3/4 inch. The faucet has an exit diameter of 1/2 inch. All parts of the pipe system are connected by screwing the pipes into the components. We call this type of connection threaded or screwed. We wish to find the gauge pressure at 1 needed to produce the flow rate of 12 gallons per minute. The first step of solving any pipe flow problem is to select an appropriate control volume. Since we want to know the gauge pressure at 1, this is a natural choice for the inlet to the control volume. The outlet of the faucet is a good choice for the outlet of the control volume because we can find the velocity, pressure, and elevation at that location. We now complete the rest of the control volume, making sure to enclose all pipes and components that the water flows through. Next, we apply the conservation of energy equation for steady flows through a control volume, using the subscript 2 for the outlet terms and the subscript 1 for the inlet terms. The total head at the outlet equals the total head at the inlet, minus the head loss, plus the pump head, minus the turbine head. Since the outlet is a free jet, it experiences atmospheric pressure, which is 0 gauge. There is no pump or turbine, so the pump head and turbine heads become 0 as well. The velocity at the inlet and outlet can be calculated by dividing the volumetric flow rate Q by the area A. Since we have steady flow conditions, Q1 is equal to Q2, and we will refer to the flow rate as simply Q. The area of the pipe is pi over 4 times the diameter squared. We can substitute the expression for V1 and V2 into the conservation of energy equation and solve for P1. The head loss is equal to the major loss plus the minor loss. The major loss equation is the friction factor F times the total length of pipe L over the pipe diameter D times the average flow speed through the pipe squared over 2G. We can find the total length of pipe by adding the length of the 6 individual sections of pipe, giving us 60 feet. The average speed through the pipes, the average, is calculated from the volumetric flow rate divided by the area. The volumetric flow rate through all pipes is 12 gallons per minute, and the diameter of all pipes is 3/4 inch. After converting gallons per minute to cubic feet per second in the numerator and converting inches to feet in the denominator, we obtain 8.715 feet per second for the average flow speed. Before we calculate the friction factor, we need to know the Reynolds number to determine the flow regime. The equation for the Reynolds number for pipe flow is the density rho times the average flow speed times pipe diameter over absolute viscosity mu. At 60 degrees Fahrenheit, the density of water is approximately 1.94 slugs per cubic foot, and the absolute viscosity is approximately 2.34 times 10 to the negative 5 pound force seconds per foot squared. The average flow speed in the pipe is 8.715 feet per second, and the pipe diameter is 3/4 inch, or 0.0625 feet. This gives a Reynolds number of 45,160. Since the Reynolds number is greater than 4,000, this indicates the flow is turbulent, and we must also calculate the relative roughness before finding the friction factor. Typical values of the absolute roughness epsilon for new drawn tubing is 5 times 10 to the negative 6 feet. Dividing the roughness by the pipe diameter and converting inches to feet in the denominator, we obtain 8 times 10 to the negative 5 for the relative roughness. We now can calculate the friction factor using the Reynolds number and the relative roughness. We could either use the Colebrook equation, the Halland equation, or the Moody chart. For this example, we will use the Colebrook equation. When using the Colebrook equation, we need to start with an initial guess. Typical values of the friction factor are between 0.01 and 0.04. We will arbitrarily select 0.04 as the initial guess. plug in the values of the relative roughness and Reynolds number into the right side of the Colebrook equation. Now we will use F to calculate the left side and right side of the equation. Starting with F equals 0.04, the left side is 5 and the right side is 7.0471. In order to increase the value of the left side of the equation, we can decrease the value of F. So we reduce F to 0.03 and recalculate both sides of the equation. The left side is now 5.7735 and the right side is 6.9306. We need to decrease the value of F further. Reducing F to 0.025 results in the left side value of 6.3246 and a right side value of 6.8563. Although there is no established criterion of when this iterative process should stop, if you repeat this process until the first three significant digits of both sides of the Colebrook equation are the same, you will have obtained a sufficiently accurate result for F. For example, if we reduce the value of F to 0.0216, the left side and right side are almost equal, and we are done. There is no point in finding more significant digits for F because the Colebrook equation is based on experiments that had limited accuracy. We also could have used the Halland equation to determine the friction factor much quicker. We solve for F by raising the entire equation to the negative 2 power. Plugging in the values for the relative roughness and Reynolds number, we obtain a friction factor of 0.0214. Although the Colebrook equation is more accurate, the result from the Halland equation differs by less than 1%. In practice, this small difference is usually negligible compared to other uncertainties in the problem, such as the uncertainty in the absolute roughness value and in the values of the minor loss coefficients. On your own, check that the friction factors obtained using the Colebrook equation and Halland equation are close to the value obtained using a Moody chart. Plugging in the values for the friction factor, pipe length, pipe diameter, and average speed into the major loss equation, we find that the major head loss is 24.46 feet. Next, we turn our attention to finding the minor head loss. The equation for the total minor head loss is the sum of the minor head loss for each component, which is the loss coefficient k times the average flow speed squared over 2g. The values of the minor loss coefficients are dependent upon the particular design of the component. We can obtain estimates of loss coefficients from fluid mechanics textbooks or from the manufacturer of the components if they provide them. For this problem, we will assume the elbows have loss coefficients of 1.5, the wide open globe valve has a loss coefficient of 10, and the faucet has a loss coefficient of 2. Notice that the inlet to the faucet has a diameter of 3/4 inch, while the outlet of the faucet has a diameter of 1/2 inch. This means the average flow speed changes from the faucet's inlet to the faucet's outlet. A similar situation occurs with nozzles, diffusers, sudden contractions, and sudden expansions. Whenever a device's inlet and outlet cross-sectional area are different, it is necessary to determine whether the loss coefficient is based on the inlet speed or the outlet speed. The source where you obtain the loss coefficient should tell you this information. For this problem, we'll assume that the loss coefficient for the faucet is based on the entrance speed to the faucet. This means we will use the average speed in the pipe, 8.715 feet per second, when calculating the minor loss associated with the faucet. We can now calculate the total minor head loss for this system. Since the same flow speed is used for all components, we can add up all the loss coefficients and multiply by the average speed squared over 2g, giving us a minor head loss of 21.23 feet. Returning to the conservation of energy equation, we now turn our attention to the first two terms in the brackets, which are the change in velocity head plus the change in elevation head. The first term is 8q squared over pi squared g times the quantity 1 over d2 to the fourth power minus 1 over d1 to the fourth power. This term is related to the acceleration of the flow from the inlet speed to the outlet speed. The second term, z2 minus z1, is the elevation change between the outlet and inlet, which is 20 feet. Note that only the difference in elevation matters, so you are free to select your datum wherever you like. Plugging in the values for the variables in those two terms, we find that the velocity head changes by 4.79 feet and the elevation head changes by 20 feet. We can now calculate the gauge pressure at 1, which is 4,398 pounds pound force per foot squared. Dividing by a factor of 144, we can convert feet squared to inches squared, and the gauge pressure becomes 30.5 psi. This means that the pressure at the inlet to the pipe system needs to be 30.5 psi greater than the atmospheric pressure in order to produce a flow rate of 12 gallons per minute through our pipe system. We can obtain additional insight into this problem by examining the pressure associated with each term in the equation. If we multiply the major head loss, 24.46 feet, with the specific weight, we obtain 10.6 psi. This means 10.6 psi is required to overcome the frictional losses due to the straight pipes. If we multiply the minor head loss, 21.23 feet, with the specific weight, we obtain 9.2 psi. This means 9.2 psi is required to overcome the frictional losses due to the six components. If we multiply the two remaining terms, 4.79 feet plus 20 feet, with the specific weight, we obtain 10.7 psi. This means that only 10.7 psi would be required to transport water uphill and accelerate the flow if there were no frictional losses. In other words, about 2/3 of the required pressure at the inlet is used to overcome friction.